Bear in mind too, we have a great number of folks joining us on YouTube Live, right? So if you're coming on to the live stream over there, hello to you. If you're logged into YouTube, you can enter questions and things in the chat. I can't guarantee we'll be able to interact with you at that moment, but we'll definitely follow up. So this looks great. Making sure our chats are running. Good morning, everybody. We have a room full of awesome folks here today to bring to you this, the Ag Innovation Challenge. This is the sixth annual iteration of this incredible event that has taken place from Marshall University with generous support from the Claude Worthington Benedum Foundation. It's my great pleasure to welcome you here today. It has been a long run-up to today's events with tons of resources provided to kind of spur challengers and others who are inventing and innovating in agriculture education across the state to come and participate and share their highest and best in a video-based contest this year with some remarkable prizes, as you will see. So the excitement is building. We're joined by several of our challengers here today. We've got a panel of judges. And you know, without further ado, I'm gonna go ahead and introduce and take some comments from our partners in this endeavor. This is Eastern West Virginia Community and Technical College. Dr. Megan Webb joins us. From the West Virginia Department of Education, we have Nathan Taylor. The West Virginia Department of Agriculture, Nathan Bergdahl. Okay, Megan, you want to take a moment for some comments about and for Eastern?
Hey, Bill. Thank you very much, Deacon, for having us. I'm going to try to get, we've got a couple different screens playing. Here we go between the YouTube and then also on the Zoom, but I think we're good to go now.
You might mute that YouTube stream, yeah, if any of you are out there with both.
Yeah. Very good. Apologize. I need to get my video working here. I'm not quite sure what's not populating, but nonetheless, appreciate the warm introduction. And I'd just like to go ahead and give some opening comments on behalf of Eastern West Virginia Community and Technical College. We are excited to partner with the West Virginia Department of Agriculture, the West Virginia Department of Education, and present the sixth annual Agriculture Innovation Showcase for 2021. Together, we are excited to be providing a virtual Ag Innovation Challenge to encourage problem solving and innovation among West Virginia students interested in agriculture. According to Merriam-Webster, the definition of innovation is a new idea, method, or device, or the introduction of something new. Agriculture innovation can improve opportunities for farming and agriculture economies. During the pandemic, at a national level, agriculture employees were deemed essential, and production agriculture sites were considered and are still considered critical infrastructure. The pandemic created more opportunities for agriculture to be innovative while it served as a spotlight for Americans. Food is a really big opportunity now, and COVID has shown how fractured the food system can be. Innovation is needed for locally sourcing food, providing contactless pickup or delivery from automation or robotic work that is continuous and self-sustained. Enhancement of harvest timelines for improving selection of product readiness and reducing waste in the form of digital platforms and technology and systematic designs to enhance direct-to-consumer sales or food box delivery for sourcing more local and regional food supplies is warranted. Now, in the first quarter of the 21st century, we've seen more technological advancements to create precision agriculture, including harvest of solar power, drone technology for aerial viewing and crop management, livestock grazing management and pasture rotation, streamlining timely transplanting, and gardening management. So what will the mid to end of the 21st century hold for agriculture innovation? Well, it's up to the bright minds of our West Virginia students that are here on this Zoom today. You may recall the legendary Steve Jobs, who pioneered the personal computer revolution and started to build the first Apple computer in his garage in California. He's the icon for backyard innovation and national scalability. As students, you have that opportunity, as Steve Jobs did, because you're the key to innovation paradigms of the future. Whether on your farm, in your garage, your backyard, your town or community, you'll have to unlock your knowledge, skills, and abilities to address challenges as agriculturalists in the future. On behalf of Eastern West Virginia Community and Technical College, RCBI, West Virginia Department of Agriculture, and West Virginia Department of Education, we are delighted to provide you this opportunity to showcase your agriculture innovation that can transform the future. As Bill mentioned and Deacon has shared, we are very excited for the sponsorship provided by West Virginia Department of Agriculture for the cash awards that would be given today, and they will be finalized today for that champion. But each of those top six student competitors will be awarded a monetary value of $100 for their innovations. And then the champion will be receiving $500 in cash on top of other prizes that RCBI is providing through the funding of the Claude Worthington Benedum Foundation. We're also really excited this year to be creative in this virtual platform and provide the People's Choice Award and also the School Choice Award, I believe. So thank you very much, Deacon, and thank you for your efforts this morning and all of your coordination. We certainly appreciate it. And that's all I have.
My goodness, Megan, thank you so much. What a great introduction. And I hope you took note of these remarkable prize packages coming up. You know, and Megan asked great questions about, like, where is the next big innovation? We believe it's right here in this room. We believe it's right here in West Virginia and in West Virginia agriculture classrooms as well. If we can bring that connection of technology, you know, to the fore, and we have some folks here who have some thoughts and comments about that. Maybe we can switch to Nathan Taylor, if you're ready, with the West Virginia Department of Education. We'll give you a moment to make a few comments about your programs. Thank you for your partnership in this incredible endeavor. So without further ado, Nathan.
Yes, Deacon, thank you very much. And thank you not only to Deacon and RCBI, but to the Department of Ag and to Eastern as well. This is a wonderful partnership that we've done again. This is our sixth Ag Innovation Showcase, and it's absolutely wonderful to have these partners that, you know, from my standpoint with the West Virginia Department of Education and the West Virginia FFA Association, that we have people that want to believe in the young folks that we have in our classrooms learning about agriculture every day. And I think that the piece that I want to hit on the most, I think that really hits home is the opening line of the FFA creed. I think really hits home to me when we're looking at what students are doing. And that opening line, if you'll allow me just to share with you, I believe in the future of agriculture with a faith born not of words, but of deeds. Achievements won by the present and past generations of agriculturists and the promise of better days through better ways, even as the better things we now enjoy have come to us from the struggles of former years. The folks that we have that are finalists here today, you young people, you are the future of agriculture. You may not realize that, but that's a very humbling thought. If you look at the achievements won by present and past generations of agriculturists, we're where we're at today in agriculture as an industry because of folks like you decades ago had an idea. And they had an idea, they had a dream, they had an innovation. And they continued to work and craft that to be able to improve agriculture and as an outgrowth of that, you know, improve the way that we all live as a whole. I mean, we all need to eat. We all need, you know, a lot of things in our life that agriculture produces. And those folks from our past that had those innovations like these young people that we have here today, that's what's been able to generate those and make those reality. So again, thank you to our partners for believing in our young people and realizing that the young people that we have here in our classrooms across the state of West Virginia, they are the future of agriculture. And by being able to have this innovation competition for them to be able to share some of their ideas and innovations is very humbling and very appreciated. Thank you.
Goodness, thank you very much. And you hit an important note, which is that while it's really incredible, the opportunity to grow things here It is also important for us to grow the growers and to make investments in opportunities so that they grow into the future, that those opportunities themselves increase fold by fold. And, you know, not just the West Virginia Department of Education with a mission that's that rich, but also the West Virginia Department of Agriculture. I'll hand it off to Nathan Bergdahl to make a few comments about your programs and welcome you here. And thank you for your partnership, Nathan.
Thank you, Deacon. I appreciate it. And thank you all for joining us this morning. With the Department of Agriculture, I have the pleasure of working with individual producers on a daily basis and creating partnerships across the state and building out the food system. And some of those projects become very innovative, very forward-thinking. So I have been able to partner and had the pleasure to partner with Eastern, the Department of Education, and RCBI since the first year of this Ag Innovation Showcase, and the pleasure to sit through all of the presentations that our students have been able to present to us. And there has not been one year that we have not walked away, just blown away by the forward thinking, the innovative mind thought that students across the state have brought to the table to show to the Ag Innovation Showcase. So again, this year we're excited. Thank RCBI, Department of Education, and Eastern Community and Technical College for their continued partnership in this, and looking forward to what the students have to offer today and the submissions. I also want to thank Jordan Masters for taking his time out of the day to present to us. Jordan, one of the most forward-thinking minds I've had the pleasure to work with in my daily duties. So Jordan, thank you for joining us. And again, thank you all for joining us. I hope you guys are as impressed as I have been the past 6 years with this showcase. So with that, Deacon, thank you for all your assistance with this too. Pleasure, sir. Thank you.
My great pleasure. You know, many hands make light work. You know, it's wonderful to have such a synergy and partnership and a connection with folks who really want to get awesome things done for awesome young people who, guess what, want to get awesome things done themselves and want to get better and better at it as they go. You know, it's important that despite remarkable challenges that we in the world, in the country, and in the state are facing right now, that we carry on not in spite of those challenges, but because of those challenges. You see, it is through our work now that we build the muscle it takes for us to be incredible producers as we go forward. So hearken back to and look forward to all the rest of the comments that we hear here today, carrying on not in spite of challenges, but because of them. This is our moment, right? So without further ado, Megan, I'll ask you, if you don't mind, to introduce our judges, right? And while you transition to that, I want to mention to the Claude Worthington Benedum Foundation and their generous support that's making so much of this possible. I want to make sure during our intro that we've talked about them. That'll foreshadow us for our prize presentations later. So take it away, Megan. Thank you.
Thank you, Deacon. We are very delighted to have five judges with us today that are going to be evaluating the students and their innovations. And I'll go ahead and start off here in alphabetical order. And thumbs up, Deacon, if you can hear me okay.
Absolutely.
Very good. Miss Sarah Biller is the Executive Director of Vantage Ventures. Miss Biller is very active in the fintech community. She is an entrepreneur, advisor, investor, and teaches graduate level courses on the evolution of financial technology of Brandeis University, I believe is how it is said. Miss Biller studied finance at West Virginia University and George Washington University. She is the co-founder of the FinTech Sandbox and currently sits on its advisory board. She also sits on the advisory board. We have Miss Biller here with us today. I'll continue on, and then if any of the judges would like to share some comments at the end, that's certainly welcome. Mr. James Coble is the coordinator of the Career Technical Education Service under the Office of Technical and Adult Education with the West Virginia Department of Education. Mr. Coble was raised on a farm in North Carolina before moving to West Virginia to teach science and STEM courses, and certainly is an asset to this year's champion judging pool. Mr. Joe Hatton is Deputy Commissioner of Agriculture and holds over 25 years of experience assisting farmers in the soil and water conservation field. Hatton also has assisted with policy development at the state and national level for the Farm Bureau. Moreover, he's been an active Farm Bureau advocate for the Young Farmer and Rancher Program. Hatton earned a bachelor's in Ag Resource Management and a master's in Ag Economics from West Virginia University. He also possesses technical certifications from the American Society of Agronomy and the American Forage and Grassland Council, providing him with science-based insights concerning the many issues facing West Virginia agriculture. Ms. Kelsey Kirby is with us today as well. She's a West Virginia native and serves as West Virginia Project Development Lead for Virgin Hyperloop. Virgin Hyperloop is an American transportation technology company that works to commercialize high-speed technology concepts called the Hyperloop. The company was established in 2014 and has recently announced the development of a new Hyperloop Certification Center in Tucker and Grant counties. Ms. Kirby is very excited for the opportunity that this innovation will present to West Virginia students for advanced STEM engagement and experiential learning. Ms. Nancy Liggis serves as the Director of Workforce and Economic Development for the West Virginia Community and Technical College statewide system. She has been working to identify and be responsive to the needs for training and education to best serve and advance economic initiatives important to the West Virginia agriculture industry. Would any of the judges like to say a few words? Okay, Deacon, back to you.
All right, excellent. Well, thank you so much, Megan. I appreciate it. Thank you, each and every one of our judges able to join us here today. Our next step now is presentation of our challenges, challengers and their entries. And they'll appear in the following order. I say this so that you guys can all be reminded to queue up and get ready. Elijah Bryant from Buchanan Upshur High School will be first. Kaylin Walton from Buchanan Upshur High. Then Cooper Riggleman from Moorfield High. Then Avery Starkey from Buchanan Upshur High. Keldon Shiftlett from Buchanan Upshur High, and finally, Drew Matlick from Kaiser High School. I will pull up your videos on our website and a note on that too. I told you earlier that let me pull up the screen share so it all makes sense as we roll. Have a remarkable amount of resources on our website at wvmakes.com. We have been working on a month-long lead up to this competition and recognized our partners. Right now we have People's Choice Award voting that's just closed. We just tallied all those today. I'm excited to announce the winners. We launched a series of Accelerator Masterclasses. Here's why I'm bringing that up. We created some evergreen content for these websites that will remain in place at wvmakes.com for the foreseeable future for you to access in your classroom. You can call on these videos that we put together, The Importance of Innovation in West Virginia Agriculture, Innovating for Success, and then Evan on here, he and I presented this one about bringing it all together, producing a quality video submission for contests. Guess what? We're not the only video contest going on in this region. You guys have entries that have been prepared and are ready for entry at other locations. So you can improve the quality and go win some more money and prizes if you know what I mean. So while we opened up voting on our page here, we allowed folks to come in and take a look at our challenger finalists. Excuse me. A quick note, although we have six top challengers, we had additional entrants, and some of whom I'll want to recognize because they too will receive some prizes for participating. Without further ado, Elijah Bryant, or anyone who's here on behalf of Elijah Bryant from Buchanan Upshur High School, I'll go ahead and cue up your video here. And for everyone's benefit, these resources are available at wvmakes.com. And you can find your way to any of these pages or these URLs by going to wvmakes.com. So while I'll try to play some of these videos, we've had some, you know, audio issues. We're having a hard time getting loud audio from the videos and putting it out. Is anyone here available to speak for Elijah Bryant's project and present to the judges? If so, go ahead and speak up for me. I see you. All right. How you doing, man?
Good. How about you?
Oh, my goodness. I'll tell you what. I'm just absolutely fantastic. I'm so happy you could join us here today, Elijah. If it's all right, I'd like to play your video and let you kind of riff on what your video is about as we and the judges kind of look through your text. That would be way better than the audio we had in the actual video itself. Is that okay?
All right, that's fine.
Okay, wonderful. All right, let me do this. All right, so your project is in animal systems, and go ahead and give us a summary.
My project, well, my invention is about a bird finder. This app will help you memorize, well, mark down on a map where your good hunting spots are, where all your grouse and birds are in the nesting and where they're laying their eggs, so you know in the future where they're going to be laying. This app also helps you mark down where you have hunted in the past and what your good hunting spots are and where your bad ones are. I invented this because we have went to South Dakota and stuff in the past for hunting trips with my grandpa and them, and he has forgot where all of his good hunting spots are. So that I came up with this app so that he could memorize where all of his good spots were.
That is totally fantastic. We're going to take full advantage of the fact that you're here to present to us. Judges, if you want to unmute and ask any questions to Elijah about his project. We have on the screen now his project summary, problem statement, and his solution statement here, which I'll scroll down to in a moment. Go ahead, judges.
This is Joe Hatton with the Department of Agriculture. Can you hear me?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, I can hear you.
Very good, Elijah. Thank you. Thank you. So as we all grow older, we all wind up with a little memory loss issues. So it's good to have an opportunity maybe to use an app of some variety to try and help remember where our favorite hunting spots are. So can you give us a little more details on how the app works? Is it GPS directed? Is it by photograph? How's it actually work?
It's on a GPS map, like on your Google Maps and stuff. You can share your location, but most hunters won't because they use this as like a diary. But if you get like hurt or something in the woods, you can share your location with your family so they can come help you out of the woods.
Fantastic. If it's okay, we might have time for one more question for Elijah. We want to make sure we move along for time. Any other judges with questions?
Elijah, I was just wondering, thanks for telling us about this. It's an awesome idea. Do you think that will hunters be paying for this app, or what kind of price do you think would go along with this app?
I think this app will be a free app so the hunters don't have to worry about paying for stuff in the future about this with this app. They need to be able to have their own thoughts on it in the first place, and then if it starts being a good app in the future, then I can probably make a profit off of it, but not right away.
Makes sense. Thanks,
Elijah. Thank you so very much. That's remarkably appreciated. Good job. Thank you, judges. All right, coming up is going to be Kaylin Walton and Cooper Riggleman. You're already on deck. You're paying close attention. I appreciate it. You'll be next. So, Kaylin, if you're here, I'm going to go ahead and feature your project here. Truly random, so give me a moment to find it.
Hi.
All right, Kaylin from Buchanan Upshur High. I'll go ahead and play your video if you want to go ahead and speak over it and tell us what we're seeing.
Okay, so my invention is a mat that goes around a tree so it can collect acorns and leaves and twigs in the fall. When I was little, my parents always made us pick them up around the yard because they would always fall into our, like, on the porch and stuff. And that wasn't a lot of fun. So I decided to come up with this invention that will help that and eliminate the problem.
Well, that's just fantastic. My favorite thing, that little guy rolls down there when you drop it in. Fantastic. All right, judges, you got any questions? I'll scroll down to the project summary and the beginning of the project statement so you can review it as we roll. This is available at wbmakes.com/vote. Judges?
I'm thinking I'll say a brief statement for our judges listening. What we will do is have a ranking in the chat box at the conclusion of playing these videos to help.
Okay, cool.
I'm sorry.
Go ahead.
I couldn't hear that. Sorry, I couldn't quite hear that.
Nobody get it? Okay. Could we have any judge go ahead and ask Kaylin a question, if you don't mind, so we at least get some interaction, some input.
So Kaylin, this is Joe Hatton again. I don't want to be the judge that asks all the questions, but I'll go ahead and ask. I assume this invention would be size dependent for the type of tree.
Yeah, depending on the tree, there would be different size mats that you could buy. And the way it's shaped, it would be like steep sides. So it would fall into a pile into the woods or in the same pile right around the tree. So you wouldn't have to rake them up and things would not get clogged into the funnel type mat.
Thank you.
Kayla, I was wondering, how do you envision kind of once all of this stuff has gotten collected, is how it then either goes, will people just bag it up and put it in the trash themselves, or is the opportunity to use kind of the material that gets collected for something else, or what do you envision happening after all the debris gets collected?
Well, as it gets collected, you could use it in a compost pile.
Very cool.
Fantastic. All right. Thank you so much, Kaylin Cooper's coming up next. I'll queue up your video.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Where are you at here, Cooper? I know you're here. I will find you. There you are. Look at that. All right. So Cooper, I'll play the video, give it a mute, and let you chat about what we're seeing there.
So I designed the flipper fork. It was an idea. I was at work one day and I had $10,000 worth of metal on my forks and I dropped it and I costed a company a lot of money. So what my invention is to keep stuff from like that from happening to other people, because I get it, you know, somebody's got to pay for it and it's not too fun to pay for stuff like that. But basically just the end of your forks flip up so that whatever you have on, pallet, whatever, is locked on and It can't go nowhere.
All right. Look at that. Great video. We got animation in there. Kind of an illustration of what you're talking about. Go ahead and give us what you got, judges. This is a fun technical one, so let's roll with that.
All right, Cooper, I'll ask the question again. This is Joe Hatton from the Department of Ag. So it looks like there's some sort of a device on the end of the pallets, forks, that twist the end up. So does that influence the integrity of the pallets in terms of how much weight they can pick up?
Essentially, yes, but it mostly is used for, like, if you had a tractor and your forks were leaking off due to hydraulics, it wouldn't let your whatever you had on fall off. Because I know that happens a lot.
Yes, I've experienced that a few times.
Yeah.
Very good.
Nice. We can take one more question, judges, if you have any.
I have a question. This is Nancy for Cooper. I think this is a great idea because I used to work in a couple of different manufacturing plants and, believe it or not, ran a forklift myself. So when you think about the usefulness of this idea, what other industries do you think this would come in handy?
Well, it would come in handy in all different industries, not only just manufacturing and companies and like your Amazon buildings. I know they use forklifts there, and it's hard to tell how much product they actually destroy and then have to resend to people. And it can also be used in the farm sense. Like I said, the leaking off hydraulics, I know that's a pain in the butt for a lot of people.
Yeah, that's important that it has multiple uses. So great idea. Thank you so much for sharing that.
Thank you.
Just fantastic. So without further ado, we got Avery Starkey up. To follow will be Keldon Shiftlet. So you're on deck. Avery, is there anyone here to represent Avery's project? Buchanan, up your high.
Howdy, everybody.
All right. Well, without further ado, I'll tell you what I'll do is play your video and let you speak over it and tell us what we're seeing. Avery Starkey, Buchanan, up your high.
All right. So my family and I, we bear hunt with dogs. And we train our dogs, and they run the bear scent. They can't tell you. They don't tell you how big the bear is, whether it's an adolescent or it's a mature bear. So my invention uses thermal energy to try to show you whether it's a mature bear or a adolescent, because you don't want to run all the adolescents. You want a big mature bear. So it uses the thermal energy, and whenever an animal with a pad puts its foot down, it leaves a heat, at least heat traces. So this picks it up, and it's good for over 24 hours, and it shows you the size, and it'll tell you how old the track is, so you know how far behind the bear you are and how, if the bear is mature or an adolescent.
All right, and you have a prototype device you're showing. I'll scroll down to the project summary, and you guys can take a look at that on the screen. Let's get some questions out here for Avery.
Hi, Avery. I'm wondering if you think that this kind of technology could be applied to other types of hunting as well, or potentially use it in kind of other markets beyond just with bear hunting.
Yeah, it'll, like I said, with the pad, every animal with the pad will leave heat. So you could use it for everything with a pad, and not like a hoof don't leave heat, but everything with a pad does.
Got it.
All right, we have time for one more question for Avery. Anybody? Very good. Avery, thank you so very much. All right, we're going to move on to Keldon Shiftlet. So, Keldon, you're up. It's Keldon
Shiftlet. Hello, how are you doing today? All right.
Okay, go right ahead.
All right, so my invention came to my mind because my grandpa, he's older. And there's a lot of older hunters out there, 40 to 50 year olds, and they got back problems and pain like that. So my invention came to my idea in my head that it helps you skin your deer without having a back pain because it focuses on the hide and it clamps on or attaches to the top of the hide and pulls evenly. So you're not stretching it or anything like that. Like my grandpa, he's like really old. He can barely pull down on hide and he can't really skin his own deer. So my invention helps you with a pulley or a cable system or a winch system that pulls the hide evenly, and the middle clamp would attach to the neck, and then the two sides would attach to the shoulder. But if you're hanging it from your feet, it just attaches to the feet, and it pulls down, and once you get them even, you just hook the rest of them on. And it's, I mean, it's a simple idea. It's not very hard, probably $70 to $100 price range. And like, I'd buy my idea if it was on the market.
All right, judges, I've got the project summary statement and the solution up. I want to ask a couple questions for Keldon.
So, Keldon, this is Joe Hatton. Very interesting. So, is this used to go and skin the deer after it's been field dressed? Is that what you're doing?
Yes, it is. Use the skin after field dress. Okay. Then it can work for bear, antelope, or any bigger game animal.
Right. And it's just a piece, it's just thin wire, then it slides between the hide and the muscle then.
Yeah, metal cable attached to two clamps.
Very interesting. Thank you.
Time for one more question, if any judges have any.
I have a question. I'm just interested as a female that hasn't done a lot of hunting. It seems like a great idea that you could do this on your own. Like, what kind of strength, does this help where you don't have the strength to do it yourself, but is this an innovation that's going to, you know, be a machine working for you?
Yeah, like a winch or a pulley, you got like a crank, a pulley crank that tightens down on the cable that's attached to it. And I mean, like back problems, you know, like straining and pulling yourself can often cause the back pain, things like that. Hang on. Like my idea right here is this middle cable right here, this little piece of wire is a metal cable, so to speak, it's just a prototype, that attaches to your winch or pulley that helps pull with your thing. And then the metal, this is a metal bar, not wood. And it attaches right here, three clamps that are supposed to be there.
So anybody can do it.
Yes.
Very good.
Fantastic. Thank you, judges. Thank you, Keldon. We are going to
thank you too. To
Drew Matlick. I see he's patiently waiting there. Let me pull up your video. Drew, and I think you presented this orally, but I'll still give you the same consideration and play your video. Go right ahead, sir. And you're muted. Go ahead and unmute. No worries.
Sorry about that. My innovation is an app that would inform producers of when the best time to vaccinate would be in relation to weather, because when the weather gets above 86 degrees, cattle, the vaccinations for cattle are far less effective, and this would help. You could plan through it with it would be connected to the weather, and it would help you to plan when the best days would be to vaccinate, on cooler days in the summer, or possibly even warmer days in the winter. And it would also give tips for vaccination tips on how to handle it. And it would also tell you when to switch out needles, withdrawal times, and when to give boosters. I think that this could help a lot with the effectiveness of vaccines. So then it could all help bring more money for producers at the sale, obviously, because the cattle would be healthier and way more. And it also could decrease the amount of antibiotics that would have to be used because they would be healthier, and that would decrease antibiotic residue in the meat in the market, which would lead to more natural meat.
Drew, thank you so very much. All right, judges, any questions for Drew?
Yes, Drew, this is Joe Hatton from the Department of Agriculture. Very interesting app. Does it have a record-keeping component within the app for each animal?
Yes, you could keep your records of when you vaccinated, so then that could help, could give you tips on when to give the booster and withdrawal times and stuff like that. And it could also give pregnancy dates for your cows and stuff, so you know when they're gonna give birth, and it could you could keep in there when your calves were born and different things like that. So
will it send you some sort of a reminder as to when you need to give your vaccinations or when you could sell an animal that maybe was treated with an antibiotic?
Yeah, it could do that.
Very cool. Thank you.
Yep.
All right, we'll take time for one more question. Any judges?
Drew, this is Nancy again. I'm just fascinated that you have so much knowledge about this. Are you yourself working in this industry or from a farming family?
Well, I come from a farming family, and my father is also a veterinarian, and he works with cattle pretty much on a daily basis. So I'm around it a lot.
Yeah, and this is where great ideas like this come from. Thank you so much.
Yeah, thank you.
Oh my goodness, I'd like to thank all of our incredible challengers, and I'd like to update you on what is coming next. So judges, you have seen the challengers and entries. I have posted in the chat a link to wvmakes.com/vote, where you can go and view those videos in the background, and you can easily scroll down and take a look at their statements, right? What we're looking for from you, judges, is a simple 1-6 ranking of the current challengers so that we can choose an overall champion who will receive our champion prize package. So that's what we need to go on in the background as we prepare to hand off to Jordan Masters of Microgenesis. Without further ado, I'll let Megan give Jordan a little introduction there. You ready, Megan?
Absolutely. Mr. Masters received his bachelor's in horticulture from WVU in 2015 and entered into the West Virginia Collegiate Business Plan Competition in 2015. He has also been part of the West Virginia Ag Innovation Challenge in 2019. After winning these competitions, he set out to turn what was an entry into a viable business. Though a remarkable amount of research and development occurred, Jordan put together a business plan and set out to change the world of microgreen production. Since its launch, Microgenesis has added a number of employees and continues to grow. It's certainly been an exciting journey, Jordan states, to combine science, agriculture, and food. Thank you so much, Jordan, for joining us today. We are very much excited to learn and hear from you.
Thank you. Thank you for the introduction. So again, my name is Jordan Masters. I'm the founder of Microgenesis, and really excited to talk about ag innovation today. I kind of feel like with innovation, if you're in agriculture at all, you're pretty much guaranteed to be an innovator. It kind of just comes with the territory. You know, if there was ever an industry that didn't have a one-size-fits-all model, it's agriculture, just because there's so many variables of agriculture, whether they be climate variables or animal or plant variables. There's just so many things that has to be taken into account with agriculture that, you know, no matter what scale of agriculture you're in, you kind of have to be an innovator to keep up with it. And because there's so many variables in agriculture, you know, looking at agriculture as a whole, it takes all the innovation that we've ever created as a society, and it takes more innovation than we could even think of to continue to feed, clothe, shelter, transport, et cetera, for the future of people. You know, and innovation in agriculture can be so many things. It's so broad and it's so diverse. You know, it can be, you know, hyper local types of innovation, you know, whether that be something like, you know, a new type of crop rotation or grazing rotation that you yourself implement on your own farm to improve your soil so that you can grow or raise more with less inputs. Or the innovation can be, you know, a larger scale issue, such as breeding or modifying a new crop that, again, you know, I feel like the whole thing with agriculture is, in agriculture innovation is, how do you feed people, how do you feed more people with less inputs? And that's what it really boils down to, ag innovation. So one thing I also want to keep in mind when I talk about ag innovation is that, you know, I like to use the terms local and global or regional or national types of innovation. I don't really like to use the terms small and large innovations, because I feel like if agriculture is to really keep up with the demand that society is putting on it, you know, there isn't room for the term small or large innovations, because every single innovation is going to be equally important as we move forward as a society. So with me personally, I kind of feel like I'm a serial innovator. You know, I've heard the term serial inventor and serial entrepreneur, but I feel like I'm a serial innovator. Like I love to see a problem and try to figure out how do you fix this problem. You know, that's kind of the stuff that really gets me going in the morning. So throughout my story with innovations, so I got really interested in microgreen production around 2012. And I guess I was really into the microgreens because there was so much room for innovation in that sector of agriculture. It was a new kind of crop that was starting to emerge, you know, which means that there was a lot of potential for finding new types of microgreens that could be produced. You know, crops that are already being produced could possibly be produced as microgreens. The technology that went along with it. So throughout, I guess, my undergraduate career, which was from 2013 to 2015, I worked a lot with the West Virginia University Launch Lab and helped develop a business plan to help secure funding to go on and actually open up my own business later on. And one of the things, you know, that I also try to keep in mind as an innovator is, you know, what can I do as an innovator to help West Virginia? You know, being a West Virginia native, I've always felt that West Virginia as a whole has the capability to be an agricultural powerhouse in the nation, because we have an abundance of land and fresh water. The only problem is, hardly any of that land is flat. So to really be a powerhouse in agriculture, we have to be innovative. We have to find different ways to compete against the larger states like Nebraska and those companies. And again, that kind of went back to my microgreens thing is, you know, as West Virginia, we can't really compete with states in the Midwest on monocropping and commodity goods. We have to think about what are the specialty crops that we can produce in West Virginia to really make an impact in the economy. And again, all of that was kind of breeding into why I got into microgreens. So in 2015, I got involved with the collegiate business plan competition and went on to win that, which was $10,000 in seed funding. And what that did more than anything was help me make more connections. The thing about West Virginia is, you know, it's not a super hard state to have an idea and to take that idea into something and make it work. You know, this state is so small that everybody is like one or two connections away. So I might not know the person I need to know, but I know somebody who knows that person. And it's really great in this state to have that kind of connections. And going through the launch lab and the business plan competitions and all that kind of stuff is what really solidified that kind of networking. So going back into kind of some of the innovations, you know, early on the innovations, you know, we were thinking, okay, if we want to do microgreens, which is a super labor intensive crop, it's a quick turnaround crop, meaning that we would sow the seeds on a Friday. And in some situations, we would harvest that exact same crop 5 to 7 days later, which means that there is a lot of labor involved. So constantly putting down seed and constantly harvesting. And harvesting at that time was, you know, according to the literature, the best source of harvesting was with scissors. And I was not really going to have that because that's a lot of time. So one of the first innovations we developed was a harvester specifically designed for microgreens. We took that design, that prototype, and submitted it to Robert C. Byrd's, I can't remember the name of that actual competition. But we submitted that to Robert C. Byrd to help get funding for it and won $5,000 to get that prototype going. And we actually ended up taking that prototype and submitting it for patent review. So that that product is still patent pending right now. The other types of innovations we were working on, you know, one of the big things with microgreens, you know, there's, I would say when I first got started, there was about 20 crops that were considered technically microgreens. And what we did was we were just like, we threw everything down that we could find as far as seed wise goes and tasted it to see if it could be a microgreen. And we found probably, I would say, another 20 more just that way that we started growing as microgreens. And then eventually we would see those seeds in catalogs. And then the other thing is blends. So it's really hard to sell like, you know, a package of just carrot microgreens because nobody wants an entire ounce or 8 ounces of carrots alone. So what we were able to do is develop more blends. Blends were already pretty popular at that time. But what we did was we worked with chefs to develop very specific blends. We worked on some blends we called the Sorrel Patch Kids, which is more of like a dessert type of blend. Which we used sorrel, which kind of gave it like a tart taste, lemon balm and marigolds to kind of give it that citrusy flavor. And then we added popcorn shoots to give it the sugary flavor. And that blend ended up being probably one of our highest selling blends just because it tasted more like candy than it did than it did greens. So those were, you know, two of the early on innovations. Another innovation that we were thinking about from the very beginning was a seeder. You know, how do we sow these seeds? Because when we're talking about microgreens versus any other greenhouse crop, is like, so if I wanted to grow, you know, a greenhouse flat of marigolds, usually it's called a cell pack, and there's 288 cells or 150 cells, and there's already equipment out there for, you know, sowing those seeds. But when we talk about microgreens, we're talking about the same size flat that would hold 288 seeds. We're trying to put in 2,000 seeds, so 10 times as much seed. So again, we were trying to develop seeders on that. We did end up developing a vacuum pump seeder that did work. But the problem was that, so whenever I think of innovations, you know, I'll have an idea, we'll run prototypes, but I have three main aspects that an innovation has to meet before we'll implement it. And it has to either save time, save cost, or increase quality. And with the seeder we were working on, it increased quality because we didn't have, you know, we could go from having somebody who's never sown before to, you know, and just say, run this machine and the sowing would come out perfectly every time. And the cost would be a little bit cheaper because it would be a little bit quicker or shorter in labor. But the time, we could never get the timing down just right to where it actually took less time to run the seeder than it did to do it by hand. So we're still working on the seeder. And then as far as like that whole business goes, you know, those, I would consider those invention type innovations. But what I really like as far as innovations goes is taking existing technology and using it in a way that nobody had thought of before. So for instance, we partnered up with a restaurant chain brand in 2017. And, you know, I was looking at the software that this chain uses throughout all 100 of their, or actually it's probably about 300 restaurants. They all use this exact same software that basically develops recipes. So, you know, if you wanted to make soup on a Monday, it would look at all of your inventory inside of the computer software and tell you, you know, you need to order celery or you need to order potatoes. And it would print out, you know, basically the recipe procedure, like this is all the ingredients that goes into this soup. This is how many cups it's going to yield and all that. And I was like, this is the exact same thing as agriculture. You know, the only difference is instead of making a bowl of soup, we're making a head of lettuce, especially in the greenhouse world, because we have ingredients, we have pots, we have media, we have seed, and we have time. The only difference is, you know, we're talking about, you know, 4 to 6 weeks of time versus 4 to 6 hours in the restaurant world. So we actually took the recipe software that was used in their chains and implemented it into our greenhouse facility. So all of the guesswork was like, you know, how much media do we need to order? How many flats do we need to sow to get this amount of yield was all taken care of overnight by implementing that software. And then we moved into the IoT world with things. The Internet of Things is what IoT stands for. So again, early on working with the same restaurant company, they were implementing little Bluetooth beacons in all of their walk-in refrigerators so that when the health department came and the refrigerator was off by 5 degrees because the health department would always come, you know, right in the middle of service when you're in and out of the coolers. You know, they could say, yes, it's 5 degrees above now, but here's our trend logs that show the difference. And they had also set up alarms so that it would alert the managers, the store managers to know, hey, your cooler's out of range. And, you know, I was like, I want that in my greenhouse, one, because I'm always worried at 2 o'clock in the morning if the heat's working in the wintertime. And then two, you know, we started thinking about it and we were like, okay, if we've got the temperature coming in and we've got relative humidity coming in, why can we not just send that information to a relay to tell us to kick on and off the water? And so we started working with that, and we started working on the back end software of what that would look like to run a greenhouse on IoT. And there was a lot of companies already out there working on IoT solutions for greenhouses. But again, thinking about the West Virginia small farmer, you know, these outfits were, you know, thousands to hundreds of thousands of dollars for even the smallest implementation. And what we had realized was that all of these IoT devices ran on the exact same computer board. And those computer boards you can buy for, you know, $5. So we developed a backend that allowed us to upload any sort of open source hardware. And the open source hardware, what that means is that it's free to modify. So let's say you buy an Apple TV, you know, Apple's got that thing locked down pretty well to where you cannot modify any of the things that make that TV run. Whereas open source would be like if you bought, you know, a non-Apple TV, and you could go in there and reprogram it however you wanted to reprogram it. And they're usually a lot cheaper. So that's what we had worked on for years, was, you know, integrating open source hardware to an IoT world so that you could automate, monitor, and record things on your farm as a West Virginia small farmer for relatively nothing. Again, you know, trying to help make sure that the West Virginia small farmer can produce more with less inputs so that they can be competitive in the bigger scheme of the agricultural industry. And then, you know, so again, like, as you can see, this is why I say I'm a serial innovator, because my thoughts are not very linear. I'm not just like, okay, how do you create a harvester and then just quit? It's like, how do you solve all the problems? you know, today, we're working on some more innovations, working with a couple of partners on developing technologies that can reduce mildews and downy mildews and powdery mildews with UVC light in greenhouses, and continue to work on the IoT solutions with WVU right now. So I guess, you know, that's my history of innovation. You know, the other thing I want to knock or hit on a little bit more is, you know, that networking piece. You know, being in West Virginia, it feels like there's not a lot of resources in West Virginia whenever you're first starting out, but there's so many resources, especially with like Robert C. Byrd Institute. Now, I'm not trying to like give them a nice little plug, because this is just their their thing, but you know, they really do have some, in my opinion, the best agricultural innovations supports. You know, like I said, the early ag development stuff that helped get the cedar going, the ag vanguard projects that they put on, and then, you know, all the other support, like the West Virginia State Agriculture has been, you know, very supportive with everything we need to get done. And, you know, again, that whole networking thing of where everybody is just one or two steps away is so nice. Cause I don't know how many times it's come up to where somebody will say, you need to talk to this person. You know, I'll be talking to somebody at the Department of Agriculture, like, you know, here's this idea I have. And they're like, oh, you know who you need to talk to? You need to talk to this person. And then it's just a chain reaction from there. But I guess that's, I see in the chat, maybe they're wanting to do some Q&A with the students. So I'm going to kind of wrap up here and go into some Q&A stuff if people want to do that. So,
Jordan, that's phenomenal, man. I hardly even have words for that. You touched on so many remarkable things from working with open source hardware and software to understanding that so many of these things that we need and can use to create outcomes are like right here in our hands. You know, we have the seeds and here's the soil. We can plant them and have a rich outcome right here in Appalachia, right here in West Virginia. And, you know, you're living proof of that, which is what's so encouraging about it. And that's why I wanted to take, you know, the last 10 minutes or so we had allotted to your time for some conversation to connect, because here we sit right across a camera from some young people who are in the same shoes you were in earlier on, innovating, working on projects, coming up with remarkable ideas. And, you know, while it's our job in many ways to get young people, inventors, innovators, and others off the runway, it's also important to teach them to fly. So having that continued support as we get up into the air and get through these incredible competitions that help give some momentum, there comes a moment where you say, you know, what comes next from here? I hope that each one of you found something really cool to be inspired by with Jordan's presentation. And if a few of you have questions, we do have time for that. So if you want to unmute and ask a question or two, especially our challengers. You know. All right, and judges and partners, if you had any remarkable things you wanted to emphasize from Jordan's talk there, I've got another piece of news to share here in a minute. And still feel free to mute and interrupt me, because Lord knows I'll just go, right? Jordan, just remarkable. I'm so glad you could join us and share this story. I really appreciate the compliments to us here at RCBI. Again, I said it earlier, many hands make light work. None of us do this alone. It's through rich partnerships and connections that we're able to pull off remarkable outcomes. But the most critical component of those remarkable outcomes are self-motivated folks with trajectory, like an upward-facing trajectory. When we find someone who has some momentum and some fervor, that fervor and momentum can be guided through, like you said, so many of the remarkable resources that we have functioning in the state, of which RCBI is part, you know, and we're proud to be. So here we are. I think that this is these digital tools that we're wading through right now are remarkable places for us to really kind of over-communicate, be really open, and have open communications with each other. And I'm gonna drop something really cool on you guys right now. First of all, everybody's a winner, because our challenger finalists will receive a prize package that I am going to detail here in a moment. But we do have a top challenger. After that, we'll announce the People's Choice Award, and we'll announce the People's Choice School Award and detail their prize packages as well. I am so excited, I'm almost like vibrating. But Jordan, I'm gonna put you on the spot, brother. Here's what we're facing. We're going to do this live. We've got a couple of finalists who are tied, and we would like to offer you the opportunity to break that tie. All our judges are in agreement, and if that's something you could do with and for us, Jordan, we'd love it. How do you feel?
Wow, that's nerve-wracking.
It is. It's exciting, isn't it? So I'm trying to look at it kind of like we've got our own game show right here, and we're live. Literally, right? So it's like Who Wants to Be a Millionaire or something. And I'm going to go ahead and announce that those finalists are Cooper Riggleman from Moorfield and Drew Matlick from Kaiser. So Jordan, if you want to review and take a look at their projects in detail in the background, after I announce our category winners, basically our challenger finalist prizes, we will just round up and let Cooper and Drew chat with you, and you can ask questions if you would like, and we'll work to break that tie. Does that sound good with everybody? Good with the judges? All thumbs? Absolutely love it. So exciting. Okay. Well, here we go. This is like my favorite part of this. this is my favorite part because we get to detail all these really cool prizes. And I'm going to kind of spotlight myself so I can show all this really cool stuff off. All right. So our challenger finalists were the top six among entrants that were selected to be judged for the final and top prize. And while we're really elated to have spent some time and really kind of invested in them, there were other entrants too. And guess what? They earned some prizes as well. I'll name them in a moment. So challengers sitting here in this room, guess what you get? You know, for being a top challenger in our competition, you are going to get a Creality Ender 3 Pro 3D printer. It is right here. One of these guys. This is going to belong to you. We are going to give you multiple spools of filament to get you started on your 3D printing journeys. Okay. This is the launch pad stuff. This is not flying. We'll get to that in a minute. You are going to receive a 3D printing pen. You know, they're fun toys, but guess what? These are rapid prototyping engines. You can literally draw things in 3D and kind of prototype in a new way than you've ever done so before. And to do this work, what you really need is tons of different colored filaments. So you're gonna snag one of these too. Isn't that nice? Well, I think we might even do one better. These things are super cool. Began using these for STEM education outreach programs as supported by, you can barely see it, Best Buy over here and Toyota up on the wall. And kids just thrive with these things. This is a silicone mat. When you extrude like 3D printing filament into these patterns, you can pull it right out of there and create remarkable structures and bridges and Ferris wheels and latches and mechanisms just with a 3D printing pen. So you can get started right in the prototyping process before you have to learn anything about 3D design or printing. And we love that. We want to see progress be a steady ramp, right? So, and then, you know, you need something to kind of organize everything into. So we get one of these big DeWalt toolboxes. Each and every one of our challenger finalists is going to receive this package. And we're really proud to be providing this and so much more with the generous support of the Claude Worthington Benedum Foundation. So I think, is that applause out here? Like, congratulations, guys. Y'all should be just really jazzed up out there. I'm very excited for you. So here we go. Now we're kind of getting off the runway. We got you some stuff. There's fuel in the tank and you're sitting in the plane and we're telling you which direction to go. And now you have a plane, right? So how do you fly? Well, guess what? So with the generous support of the Claude Worthington Benedum Foundation, we at RCBI in our innovation team here, including myself, Evan Nelson, who's with us, he's our lean and quality efficiency coordinator for ag, and Tyler Brandstetter, who does entrepreneurship and business related services for us here at RCBI, will be providing a continued cohort-based interface that'll take place over the next couple of months. So the way this will work is we will connect digitally with one another and we'll take you through a design process and take you through build processes. You'll learn everything you need to know about 3D design, planning projects and processes, you know. Jordan said a lot about that. He's like, here's how I kind of develop these ideas. We're going to show you some of those frameworks. We're going to take you through some of those processes and we're going to welcome you to this digital interface where you can work with the people who work with this kind of thing every single day. We're really excited to have you. In addition to you, the challenger finalists, we want to recognize a few applicants that we've decided to extend this to, as well as a membership to our Maker Vault here at RCBI. I'm reporting to you live from Maker Vault Studios. We've got tons of 3D printers, laser cutters, vacuformers, a CNC cutting machine, and resin printing, soldering stations, electronics kits, so much more. And we want to welcome you here with a free one-year membership and then support you with that ongoing cohort-based development. And the folks we're going to extend that to as well were other participating challengers, including Ryan Snyder, Caitlin Lance, Robin Ball, Lakota Lance, and Bryson Bastia. I knew I would mess that one up. Bryson Bastia. We really thank you for your entries and we congratulate you on your prizes, okay? And now it's time to announce announce our overall winner. And I told you, we have a remarkable tie right now. So I'll go back to the group view here. And our tie is between, you know, spoiler alert, Cooper Riggleman from Moorfield and Drew Matley from Kaiser. Jordan Masters, if you want to unmute, you can jump in here. Cooper, Drew, if you're still with us here. Jordan, do you have any questions for our top two challengers here? Our goal is to work toward a tiebreaker. And no hurt feelings, everybody wins here. I think that should be very apparent at this point, but we do need to choose that top winner.
Yeah, I will say that this is very hard because when we were going through the presentations, I was like, oh, these are the two I would choose. So I guess, is Cooper still here?
Yes, sir. I'm right here.
All right. So have you developed a prototype yet?
No, I have not, but I have laid out everything to make a prototype.
Okay. The one question I had, when somebody brought up the question about the integrity of the lift capacity being hurt, and part of that was because, you know, these are forks that have a secondary hydraulic lever that flips them on the end. Could that hydraulic lever be replaced by some sort of spring action where once you do what?
Sorry to interrupt.
Yeah, go ahead.
But I have many different designs you could go with. There is a spring loaded one, like you said, and I also have an electrical version that you would just run wires. It wouldn't be as bulky as the hydraulics, but you know, there are a couple different routes I could go with that, and I have them all in mind.
Okay. All right, cool. And Drew, are you still here?
Yes, sir.
All right. Have you developed any prototyping yet?
I have not, but I would like to get that in the works soon.
Okay. When it comes to app development and agriculture, of course, that's right up my alley with the IoT stuff. Walk me through a little bit of like what you envision like the user interface to look like. So like if I'm the farmer, and is this geared more towards like, so I was looking at your impact statement. Are you envisioning this more for like the small West Virginia farmer, or are you envision this more for the large feedlot producers in the Midwest?
Well, I guess it could be towards either one, but I had more in mind the small farmer that might not know as much about vaccinations. And I feel like it could really help to give more tips, and they could help to understand more what's going on and help them to do better with handling and stuff like that. So,
okay. And do you have any experience with coding yourself?
No, I do not.
Okay. All right. Yeah, it's a lot. All right. I'm trying to think if I have any more questions.
Well, Jordan, I think that's good. Do you feel like you're in a good spot to make a decision based on what you've seen and chatted with?
No.
No, I know. I feel you, man. We'll all look away if you flip a coin, man. I don't envy you at this moment.
Well, I am going to say Drew, just because I see the impact more with the small West Virginia farmer, and it's kind of a twofold. One, you know, I feel like with Buzz Meats developing their new facility in Charleston, having some sort of better record keeping like this, that you can show to Buzz Meats, to, you know, say, you know, this is when we vaccinated, you know, and it incorporating more of that small farmer to more of an impact on regional consumers, that's where I'm falling on this. And just that ability to have a downloadable documentation that's almost instantaneous for somebody like Buzz Meats to look at the entire record history of that cow before they process it and ship out the food, has big potential on the local food economy.
That is just fantastic. Jordan, thanks for dealing with us, putting you on the spot.
And Cooper, I'll say this, that it's a great idea. And it really just boils down to who impacts a larger amount of people. And in my opinion, the idea of Drew's impacts can impact, you know, not just the farmer, but it also creates more impact for the end consumer as well. So.
Fantastic. Congratulations to everyone, first of all, who will receive one of these remarkable challenger packages, right? And so Cooper, you have an opportunity to take your idea a little bit further, and I'll harken back to one other important point that Jordan made that I don't want to be lost here, is how powerful and how within reach networking capacity is in this remarkable state. You know, you're sitting here with someone who's done it alongside, elbow to elbow with other champions just like yourself, who've been successful at pushing their idea into this room and this really cool next stage. So congratulations as you bring on a lot of this new equipment, and all of you do, we want to support you through that continued interface here at RCBI. That said, I have to go back to go forward, because each category winner, as Megan said earlier, will also receive $100 from the Department of Ag. And we thank you for your investment in these challengers. Man, what are you guys gonna do with all this stuff? It's like baskets of stuff to carry around, right? Well, it gets even better. And I have to congratulate you, Drew, for being our overall winner of Department of Agriculture cash prize of $500. So there you go. Congratulations, Drew. I appreciate it.
I know you
do. Do I have to do the thing like on all the shows where I ask you, like, what are you going to do with the money? Hold the mic up. You know? Honestly, what are you thinking, man? Where are you going to invest those dollars?
I'm not sure yet. Obviously, I'd like to pursue my innovation and see where we can go with it, but I guess we'll just have to see.
Well, you know what? If you'd like to do that, you don't have to spend any of your award dollars on that, because we at RCBI are awarding you with a $1,000 Phase Zero Project Development Prize. This is $1,000 for professional engineering and equipment time and some materials to award the innovation of your project. And so, you know, we may be reaching out to this remarkable network here for support on some app development and software development, which it sounds like is a really important part of your project. And congratulations. I'm so excited. It's fantastic. Look at all the clapping, silent clapping. I love it. Yay. That's like we have to hug people from 6 feet away. We can clap silently in Zoom meetings, right? Oh, I love it. Absolutely. Well, there we go. Now we have two other awards to announce here, and these are really exciting as well. We have put together, with support from the Benedum Foundation, a People's Choice School Award. And it is absolutely, it's off the chain in my humble opinion. This 3D printer I showed you earlier, we're gonna give to the awarded school two of these 3D printers. We're gonna give six spools of filament to get them started. So they got printers for multiple classrooms, they got materials to get them started. They're gonna get 10 of these 3D printing pins and mats in a kit, so we can do rapid prototyping, have fun, do on-the-fly repairs. I take these things out. No joke, they'll run off a USB battery. And you have something plastic in the field that is broken on you, you can literally plastic weld it with these things. So these are absolutely remarkable, an essential tool these days. And so our winning school will get 10 pins, 10 mats, and have a package to help lead this kind of innovation in the classroom, right? some of those participants will have been in this very group and have gotten some development from RCBI. So you guys can go from see one, do one, teach one. You get to see what's possible. You get to try it yourself. You get to share it with others. And that's the power of networking here, right? We benefit from being connected to one another. And when we do, it is incumbent upon us to share what we learn with others. And so that's what we're working on. We're also going to get a little package of replacement parts and things to kind of keep fuel to keep the plane in the air once you're up there for these printers. And without further ado, that incredible People's Choice School package goes to Kaiser High School. We received over 800 total votes in our People's Choice. And, you know, many votes for People's Choice School and many votes for the People's Choice Award for an individual in the project based on their video and their submission. Okay. So congratulations to Kaiser High School, which will be receiving this remarkable package of goods. Okay. Without further ado, our final is the People's Choice winner who took by some, they kind of took the field here and, I think it was a good outcome. We had tons of votes and lots of input from lots of different people. It was competitive. And our People's Choice winner is going to win. This is a good one. This brand new flagship model of the Acer Chromebook Spin. Again, this is the flagship model for the year, provided with support from the Claude Worthington Benedum Foundation. This goes to our People's Choice winner. I'm going to risk all the sockets falling out of this thing and show you this really cool toolkit that we got as well. Look at that. We think, you know, in West Virginia, we know it's good to work smart. They say work smarter, not harder, but I disagree. I say we need to work smarter and harder. We want to work with our heads and our hands, be a new generation of Renaissance men and women that can navigate really technically complex environments while at the same time having some heft and an ability to pull off outcomes with our own strength. And that's one reason we invested in a toolkit, because who couldn't use a great toolkit? So without further ado, our People's Choice winner with our over 800 total votes between the two categories is Drew Matlick with Kaiser High School. Drew? You're going to have to unmute again, buddy. How are you feeling?
It feels good. I thank everybody that voted. Definitely. I really appreciate it.
It's fantastic. Well, we look forward to having interface with you and interface with each and every one of our challenger participants, as well as those who weren't selected for the finalists, but will be able to participate with us through a Maker Vault membership and through, our development project development through design and build steps. Okay. So does anybody have any closing remarks? I want everybody who's watching out there to watch for an email follow-up in your inbox with an important survey from our partners at Eastern. I believe, Megan, are you still with us? I know you had a meeting coming up. Didn't know if you were.
Deacon, I am still here.
Nice. Any closing comments from Eastern?
Absolutely. We just want to say congratulations to all of the 6 students today, all of the top winners. How exciting. Tremendous congratulations to Drew. Thank you to our judges for making this happen today and for helping us decipher the top winner for today's champion. And further, thank you to everyone who has participated in the People's Choice voting. Again, just a huge thank you to all of our collaborating partners, RCBI, West Virginia Department of Agriculture, West Virginia Department of Education, for joining together and being able to make this event happen in the midst of a pandemic, and being able to provide great agricultural innovations for the future. Thank you, Jordan, for joining us today. We are very, very appreciative of being able to provide this to students in West Virginia. It's been a pleasure. We look forward to working with you for the Ag Innovation Challenge in 2022.
Absolutely. Yes. So, Nathan and Nathan, Any final statements from the Department of Education and Agriculture?
A whole lot, Deacon. Go ahead, Nathan.
No, go ahead, man. You were.
Well, I just wanted to thank everybody as well. Megan, I think, summed it up pretty well. But thank you to all the participation. Drew, congratulations. Cleaning house and bringing a lot to, obviously, yourself for product development, but also to your school, which I'm sure they will greatly appreciate. So great job, buddy. Jordan, thank you, as always. Wonderful job there, too. And to all the partners and judges, thank you so much for joining us and making this a successful event. So thank you all.
I just want to follow up and reiterate again, thank you to the judges for taking time out of their day to be with our students and help them in realizing some of the dreams that they've had for the last several weeks, or some of these folks may have, you know, realized these were problems or issues that they had found a very, very long time ago. And again, thank you to RCBI and all of the partners for being able to give these students an avenue to be able to take the problems that they've witnessed in their own life to try to come up with a solution for those and have a showcase for those ideas. And Jordan, again, thank you again for so much of your expertise and time with what you were sharing there. Very awesome stuff there as well. And congratulations again to our finalists and Drew as well.
I can echo all that and thank all of you for joining us here today on the panelist side, challengers and judges alike. Thank all of you out there in YouTube land. Guess what? All of these residues are going to remain in evergreen format on our website at wvmakes.com, including the lead up videos we did to try to cultivate these challenger entries in the first place. Guidance, rubrics, there's a lot of framework there that educators can use to help prepare students for these such challenges and for being as successful as this crew was in the near future. This video will be there as well. It will remain live and kind of can be rewound at the YouTube live link that we shared. So that's already out there. And again, I'll emphasize to watch for a follow-up email, which will contain a link to an important survey from our partners at Eastern Community and Technical College, and remind you that during these troubling times, you know, it is important for us to carry on, to invest, and to push up those who are willing to push forward, and do so not in spite of the challenges that we face right now, but because of them. It is through this work that we build strength and invest in an incredible outcome for every single citizen of Appalachia and West Virginia writ large. Thank you all so much. Have a wonderful day. We'll be in touch about those prizes. Take care, everybody.